everyone, and welcome to a brand new episode of GamerKulture. I am your host, Kibbles, and it's great to be here. As you can see, we don't have Kuma this week, which is fine, because he did episode last time, and I wasn't there, so we thought, let's do one without him this time. And then, yeah, as always, we have Tyler off in the corner.
Howdy, and
howdy doody, brother. How have you been?
I've been good. You know, I'm gonna get my second appointment so I can go out and do things and see people and hug and all the other things. And so I'm excited.
Yeah, it's good. Just be prepared to be sick for the next 3 days.
Dude, it's going to hit you hard like a brick.
Oh, I know. I canceled all recordings and everything for 2 days after.
Yeah, I got mine like a few days ago. Duh. And then we have our special guest here from NerdyBit. We have Matt, or I like to call him Doug Dimmadome.
How are you doing? Dimsdale Dimmadome. I'm tired, man. Yo, dead ass. Like, I'm excited to be here. It's Saturday. I'm in school. It's near the end of the semester. I'm stressed the fuck out. But I'm here because I want to talk about some dope ass shit. And I appreciate y'all inviting me here, and I hope that everyone does enjoy this show from now on, or at least for this recording.
At least this episode, yeah, right? Recording?
Yeah, you know what I meant. Shit. Yeah, I know what the fuck I meant. Please.
Yeah, we know. It's always great to have you around.
If not, we'll just re-record it and re-record it. Just kind of like...
Dead ass. I'm fine with that. I got nothing else to do. Please.
Yeah. Kind of like our topic for today. Repeating things.
Oh, God.
Replayability. That was my transition.
Fucking recursion, man. Fucking
that was horrible. That's slightly one of your slightly better transitions
that I've
heard.
Thank you.
Yeah. Slightly better transition.
Why, thank you.
But yes, today we are talking about replayabilities that we have in games. What makes a game you want to go back and replay it over and over again? And we're trying to figure out what games we like to replay over and over again. I mean, I'm going to start off with my thing for replayability is how do I feel that day that determines what I replay. It really is. Because there's like some days where I'll wake up and I'm just bored. Like, I want to play a detective game or something like that, or a mystery game. And I'm like, okay, I'll go replay LA Noir, even though I beat that game like 5 times already.
Mm-hmm.
And just redo that.
Oh, you're the one guy who's beat it 5 times. I'm just kidding.
Yeah.
You're the only person who's beaten that game 5 at all.
Tyler, you can't say nothing about that. You're the only one I know that has a Vita. No, don't even. Don't give me that. Don't give us that bullshit. No.
And this thing was amazing.
Yep. Underappreciated and underestimated, even though it was so bad marketing.
Sony. Yeah. Fuck Sony. Anyway. But yeah.
Oh my
That's
God.
Cool. So your number one rule is essentially just like, how do I feel this day?
Yeah, how do I feel that day? Like, again, if I'm in a mystery, I'll play LA Noir. If I want to do something more fantasy, I'll play Witcher again. I mean, there's a few other things, but mainly that's what determines if I want to replay a game is how do I feel that day, and do I have a game that fulfills that requirement already in my collection?
Yeah, that's a mood. Yeah, I feel that.
Yeah. Mm.
Especially because, like, you have those rough days where you're like, man, this will make me feel better. And you just play that one LA Noir stage all over again. Look, I haven't played LA Noir. All I know is the memes about X to Doubt and F's in the chat for dead. That's all I fucking know.
That's all I know as well.
Or you ever just have those things like, I just want to kill 1,000 people in one go. I'm going to go play a Dynasty Warrior game.
Oh, God.
Or Dynasty Warrior, yeah. I think a game for me is what makes it replayability is essentially just like kind of a story that maybe I don't understand completely, or that I feel like can offer me more if I play it again, if I see a different what? No?
Look, you mean like the convolutedy and shit? So you wait, hold on, you're telling me the complex of a fucking storyline is what draws you in to replay it again, even though you didn't understand it the first time, you're like, all right, let me try this again.
If the game is fun. Let's see if I can do it. If the game was fun. So, like, Kingdom Hearts 1, I was like, there has to be something deeper into this that I didn't understand. So, I play Kingdom Hearts 1, I think I've beaten it, like, 15 times, I think. And 2, I've beaten 12. Birth by Sleep, 9. Chain of Memories, 1. I hate that game. And But yeah, and then the other ones are like in like the 3 to 4 times range, except for Kingdom Hearts 3. I still haven't beaten Kingdom Hearts 3 because it's just terrible. But also like Persona, like any Persona game, you're just like, okay, there are some stories, there are some things, there are some people that I didn't level up my com status with, and so no, I don't know. I just think I can
understand with Persona, Kingdom Hearts. It just seems like I'm playing through all of them, and then you got to a point like, I forgot how this one went, and just went back and redid it. it's like how you read a story, and then like you're like halfway through the book, and then like, or you stop for a little bit, and you come back and like, I forgot how the first half went. I better start all over again and read back.
God. Isn't there like 50 like Kingdom Hearts games?
I think it's 12. Wait. Okay. Should we break it down, or should we not waste this time?
Oh, God. Well, I mean, we have an hour to record this, so go for it.
Like. When does that video of yours come out?
Kingdom Hearts, Chain of Memories, 358x2, Kingdom Hearts 2, Birth by Sleep, Dream Drop Distance. Or I'm not going to count the Rees. You have 2.8, 3, you have Chi, you have now the Rhythm Game.
The Rhythm Game?
The Rhythm
Game. Yeah, the newest one like, is the Rhythm Game. And then,
is that with like plot though? Is that actually storyline to the Rhythm Game?
I'm forgetting one.
I haven't played it. God. I have no idea.
I'm forgetting them. But yeah, so those are the. So that's 11. I'm pretty sure there's 12. I'm pretty sure there's another one that I'm forgetting. And it's
like I get the complex of it. I get it because of the fact that some of the games that I enjoy as well, too, have that complexity. I don't even know if that's a fucking word, but sure, yeah, let's say it's a word.
Sure, if you can get away with it in Scramble, you can probably get away with it here.
That's only assuming that people I play Scramble with are also as dumb as me. But still, anyway.
I suck at spelling, so you can.
the complex of the games that I enjoy as well, too, with the storyline, I enjoy where a game has a storyline that intertwine with each other. Not in the sense of like, okay, it's a good story right then and there, but I'm talking about every other game is equally entwined with that same game. One example is Street Fighter. I enjoy the Street Fighter series. I enjoy fighting games. I enjoy playing fighting games as well, too. But Street Fighter was really interesting because there's countless, and I can't exaggerate this, countless of fighting games of Street Fighter, but there's only certain games that relate to each other regarding storyline. You know, so like the first one is the first one that was ever made, but then they made like 5 other ones. Then they made the Alpha series, which is the next in line. Then they made some other ones. Then they made Marvel vs. Capcom. Then they made Street Fighter 3, Street Fighter 4, Street Fighter 5. But none of them are in order in that way. It actually goes Street Fighter Alpha 2 and 3. Shit, what was it? It was like Street Fighter Alpha 2 and 3, Street Fighter 2 Turbo, Street Fighter 4, Street Fighter 5, then Street Fighter 3 Third Strike. That is technically the chronological order of the whole series.
My God, that sounds like a comic book series.
It is. Actually, I compare it to the Fast and the Furious series, if you actually think about it, because there's Fast and Furious 1, then there's Fast and Furious 2, then there's 4, 5, 6, then Tokyo Drift 7, 8, and 9, you know? So I compare it to that, but it's interesting the fact that they do like prequels and sequels, because even though the newest Street Fighter game is 5, it technically takes place after 4, but before Third Strike, and it you see the little connections between each thing. Yes, the game is complicated, and it's hard as shit to play against other people who are fucking professionals, but it's the storyline alone that just makes it interesting, because you see different character development. You see random characters that you haven't seen since like the first game show up in this game. You get brand new characters. You're like, all right, who the fuck is this? And then you find out that person was like a background character in another game. And now that they're a main character in this game, it makes it really interesting. You know? Yeah.
No, I'll replay a game if the story's like super, super good. Like, that's why I replay Witcher and Red Dead 2, because I really like the stories that go along with those. Like, I'll finish them like, oh, man. This is really good. I'm going to go and restart it so I can relive it again.
So, for you guys, is replayability just starting from scratch or going back to a save point or one of those massive games like Witcher, Skyrim, and stuff like that? Do you think going back and just doing side quests or just causing havoc and whatnot, does that constitute as replayability, or is that like a completely different like realm or different like a different tier of
Both?
What? Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I'm trying to figure it out.
See, I count it as opposite. I count replayability as restarting the entire thing from zero, murking your way back up. I count like stuff like was a side quest and everything, like after you beat the game. I call that like just the post content, like post story content.
So then so if you were to take a break and you come back months later, that's not replaying it, that is just continuing it. So if I'm fucking around on Skyrim, just going around killing giants and finding like and finding some side quests I didn't know about, or modding with extra quests like I did with like is that replayability or is that just continuing? That's what that like
depends on how you depends how you see it as, because it's like there's not really a line because it's still one like game itself. It's like the equivalent of DLC. Like technically speaking, you don't have to restart a game to play DLC or to do side missions and stuff, but at the same time it does give it a it is part of the game. And some people don't wait until the end of the game to do the side mission. Like my significant other does the side missions while playing the game. Actually, she does the side missions first, then actually do storyline of the game. So by the time she actually gets to the end of the game, she's so overpowered and OP, she just fucks up the boss. Yeah. That's how she is. So
that's what I'm doing with Dragon Quest 11 right now.
Yeah. Like and that go ahead.
Oh no, I was gonna say there's times in like a game where I would I only replay like certain checkpoints up there because I know it will lead to something different in there.
Yeah. Yeah, you're right. Cause it's the like the tree map thing where it goes off into different paths and different and actually that's another thing that makes the game replayable. Different endings. Oh my god. I love that.
Like Octopath Traveler and stuff like that. Like yeah.
Like it doesn't even have to be like convoluting as well, too. It can be as simple as hell. Like I enjoy playing the Sonic series. Let me rephrase that. I enjoy playing the old school Sonic series. Let me just clarify that. Okay.
What about Sonic Heroes?
Sonic Heroes. Even Sonic Heroes is as shitty as that game is, it technically does have a true ending. And you have to play it four times to actually get to that ending. You know, just like when you play Sonic and Knuckles or you play Sonic 3 or anything else, you still have to play the game. You have to play as either Sonic and Tails, Knuckles, and then when you play those, you still got to collect the Chaos Emeralds as well, too. So there's an ending, then there's the true ending, and that what makes it really dope, because you're like, oh, I thought I beat the game.
True,
oh, shit, I have to collect all these things?
Where it was a dog all along with a big stick. I'm just kidding.
I love that shit because of the fact that it makes
me... That Silent Hill 2 ending?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Just ridiculous. Even the whole, like, the cake is a lie thing from, like, Portal as well, too. When you actually play the game fully and you complete everything and do all the secret shit as well, too. I haven't done it, but I heard the cake isn't a lie and that you do get the cake at the end. I don't know.
Yeah, you do. Yeah, you do.
I have no idea.
You got to do some weird stuff.
I own them both. I have a family member who I won't name, or I have a family member who worked on the games, and I still have yet to play those games. Also, you and I have had this conversation before. I have also never, ever, ever played Sonic before. I've never played a Sonic game minus Sonic.
I don't know if that's Sonic a good Adventure. Thing or a bad thing.
I played Sonic
point.
Adventure on the Dreamcast for like a little bit. My friend let me play it.
And that's
That
don't count.
Yeah, it was just me. It was just me in a city carrying like a little blue thing, and I never got to like do any of the action.
Oh,
I walked around.
You never got past the ice caps? Are you serious?
I guess
you
not.
Got past the ice caps.
He only let me play for like 10 minutes, and I couldn't figure out what anything was.
Fuck
and
your
he,
friend. That's some bullshit. You should actually get the. Actually, I'm going to make you play these games.
I won't say
I
that.
Swear to God.
He gave me his N64 for free when he got the Dreamcast because he knew that my parents wouldn't get me video games. And I can't say fuck my friend because he was a very good friend. He gave me my first console. So.
Fuck him for that situation, because Sonic Adventure is one of those games where you actually need to play through. Yes, it's glitchy. Yes, it was bad, all that stuff. Because, but for what it was at its time, it was really good. And even as cringy
revolutionary.
And shady. Yeah, it was. It's hilarious, especially because when you find out the little secret that the reason why the voice actors sounded so weird in the game is because the translation from communicating from Japanese people to American, they didn't know what the hell was going on. They didn't understand like the pitch of tone. So there are random times where it's supposed to be a serious situation and they're kind of talking like, hey, I'm happy as hell walking through this thing. Like it was because of mistranslation and miscommunication. Which
hey,
makes
are we
going to really
die today? Like, yeah.
Because the Japanese version, like the actual Japanese game, sounds completely fucking different. Man, it sounds completely... It sounds like it's an actual, like, storyline. It's really in-depth as well, too, and it's actually damn good. Yeah. Okay? Mm. But still, I'm going to make you play a Sonic game. I'm going to make you play a Sonic game.
No, I'm down.
I'm going to make you start from one. You're going to start from one.
Okay.
Yeah. I literally...
I also never played Mega Man, so...
Oh, hell no.
I played Mario, Mortal Kombat,
Kingdom Hearts. Mega Man. I'm not good at Mega Man.
GTA,
I played
Mega Man. That's it.
I love Mega Man X.
Like, oh, and Paper Mario. Obviously Paper Mario.
Please tell me you at least play Super Mario World. Please, at least.
Oh, of course. Yeah.
Okay, just
make
sure.
I have it on my... I should have it on my...
Just make sure.
It's on my partner Switch, yeah.
Oh, thank God. Okay. Okay, because I'm about to say blasphemy.
Me and Kuma kind of ask, like, secretly, why do we keep having him on this show? I don't know.
So I'm going to make you play Sonic, I guarantee you. But because of the topic we're talking about, what makes it replayable, soundtracks, speaking of Sonic, is the soundtracks alone is what makes a game replayable to me. Like, I enjoy playing a game to where I can listen to the music over and over and over. If anyone has watched our most extreme ranking challenge, the soundtrack episode, people know I am passionate, very passionate about my music. And I will fight to the end of the day about Jet Set Radio and even the Sonic soundtrack as well, too. Because Sonic Mania was really good. It basically took older stages. They gave you the nostalgic feel of, like, the older games. But then they made, like, remixes of those stages as well, too, which sound dope as fuck. And those are the things that makes me, like, replay a game. Just even though I beat the game 100 times, if it has a good soundtrack and it has a dope song that gets me hype, I will listen to it. I will play it. I will go on YouTube and... I will go buy the actual soundtrack and everything because, definitely made a Sonic 3 soundtrack. Mm-hmm.
I literally bought games because it will come...
Did they just
reuse?
Is that what you're saying? Like, didn't they just reuse everything?
No, what they did was they took... Well, it's more in-depth into it, but the quickest summary is the fact that they took previous stages of the Sonic games and put them in Sonic Mania. So they made a HD version of the first stage, but then the second stage was always a remix of that stage. And it sounded really fucking good because it gave you the good feel of what you played in the past, but with a newer twist. So it didn't feel old.
It's like how every Sonic game always has to have a Green Hill Zone in some way, shape, or form.
In some way, whether it's Green Hill, Emerald Hill, Mushroom Zone, it's whatever it is. They always have to have some kind of remake of it, even if it's the same song remade again, but it just sounds cleaner, better, or more techno-y, as I call it, you know? So that comes into play as well, too.
Yeah, but no, I do agree. A good soundtrack helps with the replayability. When I play Witcher, I've always get excited for one particular song in there. And that is, like, halfway through the game, you're in Novigrad, you meet a...
Toss a coin to your Witcher?
No, not toss a coin to your Witcher.
I know.
You meet
Is that in the game?
No, it's
not. Is that an actual song? Oh, that's not an actual song?
Whoa. That's a song in the Netflix show.
Yeah.
That's in the Netflix show. But it's not in the game. Really? No, but you go meet one, like, a troubadour, and she sings a song called... Woven Storm, which is about your Geralt's love affair with Yennefer, and I personally like it because it's the most beautiful song I've heard, and it's like I think it's an absolutely beautiful song, and like I'm like I always sit through that cutscene. They play the entire song, like 3 minutes of it in like a cutscene. Like I'll just sit there, I'm like, oh, this is so beautiful, just listening to this over.
that's good. No, that's actually really good. Because
and then I also just got the newest Scott Pilgrim game on my Switch. Ooh. And I've been playing that a lot more because
that game, by the way.
Yeah, it is.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
I have it on my PS3, and I beat it once. It was hard. I just remember it being really hard.
It is.
It's an old
supposed to emulate. Yeah, it's supposed to emulate the old beat 'em up games. Yeah. Those are really hard.
Arcade games, they're super hard.
I used to play with a friend, and so now that I have it on my Switch and you can't really play with a friend, I'm just like, oh crap. Am I gonna do okay? Because I got the same thing where I got the limited run, but I got the bigger one because I'm a Scott Pilgrim fanatic.
Yeah.
And there's not a lot of Scott Pilgrim merchandise, and so I was like, I'm gonna
Not merch. No. You have no idea. Like, look, I've never really played the Scott Pilgrim games or anything. I saw the movie, I read the comics, and I have a shit ton of hentai of Ramona and knives. That's it. That's all I got. But otherwise, besides that, I understand why the game is so good. Like, I've seen it, and it reminds me of, like, the old school Streets of Rage, as well as, like, the Double Dragon games as well, too, which that shit is fun as fuck. Yeah. So,
and I personally, like, so far I'm liking is I like to... I replay so many, like, levels in there just because I like to get money and then buy stuff to level my character up. And currently, right now, I'm at a point where I found a store. It's a video store that just says, pay $500 for Scott's late fees. I'm like, I wonder what that unlocks.
Yeah. Oh,
so I've just been farming, trying to see what I get out of that.
Absolutely. But
I hope it's something, man.
Yeah. But back on our topic about replayability. Yeah. Did you have anything else to talk about regarding Sonic?
No, but I was going to transition to something else, but don't worry about that. Yeah. Y'all can go ahead.
Well, no, I was going to say, like, because we were talking about fighting games earlier, and there are only a couple games that, like, I love Mortal Kombat. I've always loved Mortal Kombat, but I gave up after a while. Like, after, like, Shaolin Monks came out, and then they just started making, like, Armageddon and a bunch of other ones. Like,
we do not acknowledge Shaolin Monks. No, we don't acknowledge that. Even though it was fine for what it was.
It was
not a Mortal Kombat game, in my opinion. No.
It was better. It was it was better than that shitty Sub-Zero game.
Yes, it was. I agree with you 100% on that. Mm-hmm.
Thank
100%.
You. Here's the thing is, I'm also in the minority. I loved the game Deception. I love Mortal Kombat Deception because we actually got to walk around and have that RPG element. We got to go through all the different realms. I know. I love the story mode. I didn't like the fighting. The fighting was terrible and horrible and clunky. But I think it's because they were so limited. Of course. I wanted to walk around Netherrealm. I wanted to walk around and meet the gods and, like, see Shinnok and actually just talk to him. Talk to Scorpion and just be like, I have a side quest for you. And you're like, yes, Scorpion, that'd be amazing. And do the same thing with, like, Sub-Zero and everybody else. See, like, multiple of Baraka's people just hanging out in a tribe. It was, like, the coolest thing. I really liked the game. I also understand why people didn't like the game, because especially around that time when it came out after like Final Fantasy IX and like a bunch of other like really big staple RPGs that were like unbelievable, and RPG was really finally shaping itself as to what the hell it was supposed, like, basically the RPG genre was perfecting itself. And and so when Deception came in and like, hey, can we be added? And they're just like, no, you're not one of us. Go sit at that table. Like, it's not as good as the other ones. But for Mortal Kombat, I really thoroughly enjoyed it. And I actually like the Sujinko character. And it was really cool when he came back. But anyway, I digress. I actually care more about Mortal Kombat after the reboot with 9. And 9 on has been fire. I've really liked it. I've thoroughly enjoyed it and have been happy with a finally reboot with an actual storyline, trying to really, because before everything was just kind of random, they were just like, ah, everybody just fights. Now we actually get to understand more people and more of the hierarchy and
sure
stuff
about that.
You don't think
sure
so
about that? No, yeah, here's the thing, like the older Mortal Kombat did actually have a storyline as well too, but because of how it was back then, you couldn't tell what the storyline was unless you read like the secret pages and Wikipedia or whatever the fuck it was. I don't remember what it was back then. You know those books like the gamer guides and shit?
Yeah,
those the what manuals. Told the storyline
yeah.
of like different Mortal Kombat games as well too. And I was too poor to afford it as a child.
And you know? if you're like me who only ever played Mortal Kombat when your parents went to go pick up a pizza and you're sitting at you're waiting for the pizza and you play on the old arcade machines.
Yep.
That's pretty much it. That was like my only experience with Mortal Kombat.
I would just play at my friend's house, but yeah.
No. I feel that because like at that time I was at an arcade and all that stuff. What made the Mortal Kombat newer ones good, in my opinion, was that nostalgic feeling. They basically went back to their roots of how it was back then when it came to fighting games and when it came to like how it was in the old arcade game. Like, yes, it's a newer mechanic. It's a newer structure as well, too, because, you know, fighting games have updated throughout the years and everything. But that nostalgic feeling that you have when you can bust out a fatality, and it actually looked gruesome as hell, and then it made sense. And you had to put in the proper sequence. That's what
I
made it good.
I always failed. I think I've only... I've played a lot of Mortal Kombat. I never really focus on the fatalities, and that's on me.
This is why you need an arcade stick. You need an arcade stick when you play Mortal Kombat. Yes, we're talking about Mortal Kombat, and this is Akuma for Street Fighter. Ignore that. But still, you need a fight stick when it comes to these old school games.
Maybe I
might
buy one, but I also don't play very often now. And so
you don't need
to
play often.
I don't have anything online, really. Yeah,
I got you. We'll talk about that later, but I got you.
That'll be a topic for another day.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. But still, it's that nostalgic feeling that Mortal Kombat did, which made like 9, 10, 11, even 12 really good as well. Even though it is a newer game and all that stuff, you still feel like you're playing an old school Mortal Kombat game, which that makes a game replayable when you feel that nostalgic old school feel that you like grew up with. All right, if you grew up in a bad situation, then, you know, never mind, ignore everything I'm saying right now. But if it wasn't that bad and you gain like happiness and like comfortness when you were playing certain games when you were younger, that adds on to it. Like, I, to this day, bust out my Super Nintendo, and I still play the Goof Troop game once in a while just because I grew up with that shit. And I watched Goof Troop, and I love Goof Troop and everything. And playing as little Max before he grew the fuck up was dope as hell and everything, you know? So, like, it's that nostalgic feeling that you get.
I've done that before where I would go, because I didn't have it at the time, but it's like, when I would go to my cousin's house for like a family event, and they would have a Super Nintendo with Super Mario. I think it was Super
classic.
Mario. Yeah. So
no matter
would,
which
I would
one
go, on, and I was like, even at like 15, I would just go, like, I haven't played since I was like 5, but like at 15, I'll still go over, like, I'm just going to sit and replay Super Mario on, just replay it over again. Like, even though I know it's like, oh, this game came out like 20 something years ago. Like, I don't give a fuck.
So, yeah, I agree. I played Super Mario World actually just last week. I was like, hey, I'm curious if I can unlock all 92 like exits and everything. So I just went through all of it. I did all the secret levels. I did the Star World. I did the hidden levels, like, just to see if I still remember it from when I was a child. And I'm missing one, but I got most of it. So
yeah. I think another game that I replay now, and I really don't know why I do, because there's nothing added. I think it's because of the creativeness of the game and what you can do and different options of what you can choose. Untitled Goose Game is like so replayable for me.
God,
that
so
game.
Good. Oh,
why?
That game is really good.
Why is it
good?
So replayable? I know you can do things differently, but you're really not, in all honesty. Like, you're really not doing anything any differently. But like...
I can explain that. But there's only two reasons why. Because one, you play as a goose. That goose is fucking adorable. It's so cute. And like, it makes me want to be a goose, even though I'm a large black man. And that's bad. I want to be a fucking goose, right? Okay. And second, is because
you're not
it's
a goose?
Game.
Shit.
You don't think that, okay? Just because I honk doesn't mean I'm actually a goose. But still, the simplicity of the game is what makes it fun and replayable as well, too. You're just walking around doing basic tasks, and you're figuring out little puzzles and everything to get through. It's been, if you really think about it, compared to how newer games are, it's not common to see like little puzzles in a game where you have to solve to move on to like another task or to another level. Yes, there's a boss. Yes, there's things you have to find, like hidden collectibles to unlock some stuff. But if you really think about it, when was the last time you had to solve a puzzle to actually advance forward?
Yeah.
You know?
I feel that way with
I mean, Resident
games.
Evil.
You know what I mean, though. Like, that don't count, okay? Especially
I feel that with the Portal games, because all Portals is like, here's like 20 to 50-something puzzles you got to figure out.
I know
out.
A ton of people who and replay that game over and over and over again.
I do it just because it makes me feel smart when I get it right. When I get it right, I have that adrenaline, like, I am a smarty. I did something right.
Mm-hmm. Nah, that's a mood right there, because you can't, like, feel smart when you're playing Sonic. All you do is go fast. That's it. No, that don't hurt the brain. That doesn't do nothing to the brain. But
Mario,
though.
you just jump and be fat and sometimes fire.
Right? Is there any Mario game that has like puzzles? Now that I think about it,
Paper Mario,
Paper Mario, and I think like Odyssey.
Mario's missing.
I think maybe around the 3D time they started experimenting with puzzles, but like early on it wasn't like anything.
Didn't
really...
Luigi's Mansion have a few puzzles in it? Or yeah, I don't play Luigi's Mansion.
I think it does, yeah.
Sweet.
Yeah,
not a Mario game, but
Luigi's Mansion is a different ball game, and it happened again. It's when I move too quickly and the camera can't capture me. That's what I've been trying to do. I've been trying like to not move. I've been legit trying not to move or anything. But anyways, the complexity of the puzzles that makes it really interesting and stuff, right? Like Luigi's Mansion, I think had a few, but like Luigi's Mansion was kind of built around puzzles, if that makes sense. Like you have to solve stuff, you have to find stuff, and you have to solve stuff for Luigi's Mansion. But any other Mario game really doesn't have that, if you really think about it, you know. I mean Mario Kart, yeah,
I mean, but Legend of Zelda. I mean, the extremely infamous Water Temple.
Fuck that.
So that's true. That because quite honest, I like a fuck few weeks ago, I kind of went back and I started replaying Twilight Princess on my GameCube.
Oh, mm-hmm. Really?
Yeah.
You know, I've never played a Zelda game too.
Dog, what the hell did you?
I know.
You didn't do weird. Child.
That is so strange. I got N64. I had GoldenEye, Mortal Kombat, Paper Mario and Mario 64.
You missed all the big games.
And then I jumped to the PS2 and got my only game was Grand Theft Auto 3, and something else and Kingdom Hearts. That's all I owned on my PS2.
I was blessed. Shit.
So yeah. So
I was, so don't get wrong, I didn't own any of it. This is all my father. My father was a collector, because if anyone who is old listening to this knows what KB Toys is, my father used to work for KB Toys. So he was a collector of games and different stuff. So I got lucky growing up with all the games of all the, so I started from like the first Mario game, you know, like the regular Nintendo. I played every game in like order. It wasn't until PlayStation. Actually, it wasn't until PlayStation where I had to stop gaming for a little bit, because that's when shit got expensive. We're like, all right, we can't afford that, and he no longer worked for KB Toys. So I missed out on PlayStation 2, and it wasn't until PS3 when I got my own job where I was like, fuck it, I'll buy a PS3, you know?
Oh, so. My God, I remember KB Toys. I remember seeing these in the mall.
Yeah.
They used to be everywhere. Now they're not.
Yeah, everywhere. Wow. It used to be like EB Games, and then EB Games is fucking gone again. Gone.
Yeah, now Toys R Us is taken away from us.
Yeah.
Is it? I thought,
They're
coming back as like an online store, is what it is, I believe.
That's some bullshit, but I guess. I mean, it makes sense, but whatever.
Yeah, the board members gave themselves a raise and then did the bankruptcy thing, the bullshit. They did the evil thing. And everyone is just like, oh, but they're coming back. And I'm like, why would you support them now? Like, what the hell is wrong with you? I'll never support them.
Nostalgia, I think, at that point.
Yeah, that's nostalgia, but also what you call complex shit, which goes into our next segment, complex shit, okay? What makes a game replayable to me is something that's complex that requires, like, technique and hand-eye coordination, you know? Like, those are the types, like, anyone, I don't like Call of Duty games, but I respect anyone that can actually play a Call of Duty game really good, because that requires hand-eye coordination and technique that you have to master and figure out. You may have no life, but you still figured it out. Like, one of my favorite, not even a nostalgic game, but, like, a game that I can play over and over and over is, like, Dance Dance Revolution. I love DDR. Love with a passion. Goes into soundtrack, goes with how complex it is in technique, because you have to be at least decent to understand how to play that game, especially when the arrows go up. You have to have rhythm as well, too, because you can't just play that game with no rhythm.
I
you know?
Suck at DDR, but I am always amazed when I go to, like, Round one, arcade, and there's that one kid that's just like grabbing onto like the back bar, and his feet are like going like crazy. I'm like, motherfuckers, man, it's too much.
Not only is that like complex, also that also requires you to have money too, because each of those games for you to play a level, that's like $1.50 every single time.
Yeah,
up once, you're done.
I'm too broke for that. I mean, back in the day, they just had like here's a home version, and then here's a pad. But the pad's never receptive.
Yeah, it took time. Which is funny because they built metal ones of that stuff as well too. So
yeah, and you kind of just had to like you stomp on the ground. And if you're like me that live on the second floor,
your parents don't like it
when you stomp on the ground, and then they'll come like, "Hey, you gotta stop that."
Really, mine just loved. I'm just kidding. They wouldn't let me play video games. So
no. Hey. Well, I appreciate when people are like that good when they get like complicated. Like. I was watching someone like they were doing streamings of Call of Duty, and one of them was like, I'm going to perform a 720 YY no scope. I'm like, what the fuck is that?
Was that? I know what it is when you say it, but I'm like, I don't even know how you do that. How can anyone take the time? That's that shit where people like sit in a game and just practice that over and over and over so they can do, so they can actually perform it on stream and to get those views and stuff. Cause that's not just luck. That's fucking skill.
Yeah. Like complex stuff like that. Like I personally don't like it cause I'm not that hand eye coordinated, but I can appreciate it.
Not at all.
That's a mood. Y'all are crazy.
I'm so bad at like the reaction, like reaction stuff in games. Like I just can't like, I'm like, no, really? Like, yeah, I get distracted, you know, I have ADHD, so I get really distracted when I'm playing games and stuff. And like, that's why I like turn-based games. I can just take a break, walk away, go do something else, or like check my phone or something like that. And then I'll be like, okay, now I know what to do. Or now I'm okay to attack. I'm terrible. I'm the worst. I'm sorry.
I do have one thing is I count as replayability is, roguelike games. Like I've been also playing a lot of Hades, and I find that replayable because that's like the one genre game where every time you play it, it's never exactly the same because they move stuff around in the game.
Oh my god, yeah.
And I think that's the new genre of like replayability is you can always play it and always be technically because they're different orders, it's never the exact same playthrough.
Well, here's the thing.
So much randomness added into it.
Well, it's the, I guess the randomness of the rooms are random, but the random order itself for like characters and like bosses and all stuff, that stuff's been around forever. Because I love Diablo. Diablo 3 is one of my favorite ones, and like the randomness of what boss and what level you play, such as hardcore mode or whatever, when you start from level zero and you have to work your way up and all that stuff, and you're playing through the story and you're playing through the maps, but each thing is different because of the legendary drops that you get and the weapons and all that stuff. So it changes the gameplay every time the further in the game you play. And I guess that's the same with Hades, I think.
Yeah, Hades is the same way where it's you basically every room starts off the like, you always start in like one main room that's like always the same, but then every room like it's like different.
It's like Birth of Isaac. It's like the Isaac game, but you have a little bit more control as to what the next room may be because you can get either like a really good weapon or an upgrade, or just keep going on with what you got.
Yeah. Okay,
you
that makes
get,
sense.
You have a little bit more decisions as to which routes you take.
But yeah, you can also get like a special item from like each of the gods. Like I always start off with the one from like Athena, where it's like this has a better chance of getting this god's ability, or for this god to show up in the next room.
Mm-hmm.
And for me, I do that because it gives me a better chance of guaranteeing I start off with what I want all the time.
Really need to play this game because I've been wanting to play Hades for like a little bit.
I haven't played it yet, but I've watched a ton of people like Andrew Lundy and a few other people who played it.
I got like Twitch. 35 hours into the game. I like it. I think you'll like the soundtrack because I find
Oh yeah, sounds amazing. Oh hell yeah.
Yeah. That's the audio in there is really good. Like you really like get to hear like all the punches and everything, and that's why I really like the audio for it.
So here's my question for y'all. Yes. When it comes to a replayable game, does online play is important to you, or what do you think?
I don't play online games except for Sea of Thieves. I hate playing games online. That's my issue.
Ooh, yeah, I get that. Now that's understandable. The only reason I'm a very
selfish gamer.
No, that's understandable. The only reason I'm saying is because interaction online is also important to me because of connection and stuff. I will admit this on camera. One of the brothers, I fucking love Among Us. I think.
Oh yeah, I forgot about
the
Among
people
Us. Yeah.
Who made that game. Those are some clever fucking people because that is not only a simple game, it's a simple game where you do simple tasks and you lie to everybody. I think you have to play that with a full room of people, and that is really good because not only does it connect you with other people and it's fun and interactive and you get to like engage with other like people and shit, but at the same time, something as simple as, hey, I was in Medbay and everyone's going to vote you out just because you said something weird. I think that is the most clever shit ever.
No, that's a sleeper hit game because that game's already been out for like 2 years before mainstream gamers.
I get it, and that's what makes me sad because of the fact that game was so damn good.
I want to play it more on our Discord for sure.
Fuck.
Yeah.
So good.
For me, it depends on the game. Like Tyler, I usually prefer one player games. But if, like, if I know like a shit ton of my friends have this game and we like playing online and they play online, I'm more likely to do play for the online feature. Like
you in Final Fantasy 14 that you play every single night.
Yeah, we do that. I play that every year. Night, and that's because my friends are there. And then
that's the road trip one.
Or we
no the 14 the MMO one.
I don't play Final Fantasies. No, sorry.
No, this is the only Final Fantasy game I've played is 14. And
I used to love Final Fantasy. I mean, I don't. I mean, I've everything I've seen and watched you guys play. Whenever I would come in and like whoever's streaming it in your Discord, I'll like watch them play it for a little bit. It looks really fun and cool. Yeah. I just don't want to play it. Like especially because hell no. Like. Well, you guys are so advanced that you wouldn't want to play with me anyway. B, I don't want to make new friends, and so yeah, no, screw that. Like,
fair enough. You got your thing. I played Splatoon for a while with friends. We played that. We did Monster Hunter for a while until we got to the point in Monster Hunter where we couldn't level up anymore because this is the thing is like. They do stuff where, like, okay, you go by ranks. As far as I know, there's supposed to be 10 ranks, but when they release the game, there's only 7, and they're slowly releasing more as the game goes on. And we're like, well, we already got to the max, and we're already leveled out. I don't know what else there is to do.
Nah, I feel that, because that's the same with, like, Borderlands. Like, at one point, you hit the max, and you have to get the DLC to, like, increase your levels and everything. And then from there, by the time you want to play with other people online and stuff, it's the fact that everyone else is low level. You're already overpowered, and it's like, well, what's the fucking point? Now, I get it.
Yeah.
I get it 100%.
No, it depends. It depends on, like, certain conditions on whether I'll replay a game for online features.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. I'm just wondering, because, like, online feature is a key thing for me to replayable. That's why I have a love-hate relationship with Street Fighter, because I love Street Fighter, but the online fucking sucks. Like, oh my god, it fucking sucks.
I was watching our friend Black Skills or Paul play on Twitch the other night. We were joking around with him, and you know, he's really good. And
he's really good.
He was telling me a lot of the stuff, like especially like with the new one, where like all the maps or all the fighting rings, or are they called like
the stages.
The stages. There we go. Wow, yeah. Tyler, come on. But like the stages. Online, the only one that really works is the training stage, because the other ones are too big, and so it doesn't really work with a lot of people. And so, like, that's the connection. Sucks. That's it's like the bullshit to me. I'm just like, no, like, that's why I can't play online. Like, when Mass Effect 3 was like, oh, yeah, play online for better, I'm like, fuck no, absolutely not. I'm just gonna beat this game. Fuck all that shit. I'm
yeah, gonna, no, I'm 100%.
Play Mass Effect with other people, bullshit. Nobody's sleeping with my Talia.
Like, the stages are so beautiful. Like, there's a stage where you're, like, at a beach, and it's, like, so nice. You see the waves and shit moving. But because of the animation in the background, it flows the game online, which makes the connection worse, which kind of fucks up everyone. The training stage has nothing. It is literally just a gray stage with some lines.
With grids,
nothing.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So, like, it's bullshit. Fucking bullshit.
Yeah, that's why I'm just like, yeah, I would never play this. Like, I play Mortal Kombat, I just play against the CPU. When I do Smash, I'll play with friends. Other than that, CPU. Like, I just.
Yeah. I like how you mentioned Smash. Like, because one of the things that makes a game replayable for me is
a bunch of characters.
yes, crossovers. I love crossovers. Like, when there's multiple games that I enjoy, and then, like, they end up doing like a collab or something together where they're both into it. Oh, I fucking love that shit, dude. That makes the game replayable to me. Marvel vs. Capcom, Marvel vs. Capcom 2 is still one of my favorite games. Just purely the fact that I can play X-Men character with fucking Street Fighter with a side of fucking Darkstalkers as well, too. Like, oh, it's fucking awesome.
Ace Attorney.
Ace Attorney. Yeah, no, seriously, he's overpowered.
Ace Attorney's on my Capcom.
Objection. Mm-hmm. I cannot play those games. They're way too hyper, way too fast for me. I have zero concept of why. I'll be playing and smashing buttons, and then I'm dead like 10 seconds later. I'm like, how did I die? What happened?
I don't even know what's going on. I personally am terrible at like fighting games, which is why I never got into like Mortal Kombat or
like the slower ones like Mortal Kombat. And
I want to clarify, you need a fight stick, okay? Get a fight stick. Just saying. Get Fight Stick. This will help you play better, even though not really. Get Fight Stick.
There are two other...
I'm doing this because I'm proud I rebuilt this shit, and like, that's it amazing. Looks dope as fuck, so I'm doing it this for myself.
No, it looks amazing. There are two other things that gets me to replay a game. I also like innocent, fun adventure games, and if I'm feeling down or feel like I just need an adventure, especially during these times, there are two games that I will go for. Blue Dragon on my 360 for sure. It's Akira Toriyama, the creator of Final Fantasy, together making this fun, funny, also very serious, but also not too serious game that, and it's so good. It got overlooked. Nobody played it when the Xbox.
Wait, you said Akira Toriyama?
Yeah.
Made Final Fantasy?
No, Akira Toriyama and creator of Final Fantasy. Yeah.
I thought I was crazy, and I'm like, hold up.
Yeah, they worked on
both? Shit.
No, they did the Dragon Quest series, and then they made Blue Dragon for Microsoft because they were like, I have a new idea for a story. I would really want to do this. And so, like, but they couldn't do it with Dragon Quest because it didn't work with the mechanics, and you know, like, it was a completely different kind of game.
Yeah,
I mean, yeah, there's dragons in it, but they're shadows. But anyway, I love that game. It's like a 20-hour game on three discs on the 360, and it's like the best soundtrack ever. And it's just one of those games I just love to play because the characters are just so innocent. It's just kind of fun and not a lot of weight to it. Like, and
It sounds like the rareness of a game is something that you enjoy that you'll replay again.
Yeah, exactly. Or something that's just like, yeah, like, there's not a weight on you. There's not a lot of stress for you to, like, finish it. Like, it's just like, you just play as you will and you keep going. And it's turn-based as well. And then the other one is something I talk about all the time, which is Paper Mario, which is the same thing, where it's just fun. All recognizable characters that we do love. Kind of the same thing as to why I love Deception from Mortal Kombat Deception. Because it's like characters and things that I've always wanted to see and love and get to like talk to and just take my time exploring. Mm-hmm. Unlike just side-scrolling and just going around jumping and killing things like in, you know, Mario 64. Paper Mario and Mortal Kombat Deception are just kind of two games where it's just like, okay, I have loved these worlds. Now I want to get to know these worlds and talk to people without having a fight or a boss battle all the time. And, like, do whatever I want. And that's something. And those are just two things I like. And that's what helps me get back with games. What we're talking about with Smash is, like, seeing games I love and characters I already loved and now having the ability to explore the world and explore a little bit more of them as well. So.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, please tell me we really still have smart. That graphic of...
All you Tyler talks worry. About.
No, it's like I can understand where it's like sometimes you're in the mood of like I just want to fuck around in game. And for me, my those two games are either any of the Saints Row series are really good. Like I just want to fuck around for a few hours. Or
I've only played them once and never again.
Or the GTA series, or I play like GTA 5 and like I just want to fuck around. Let's play either of those games really work.
See, that's the thing. Is like, I hate the GTA 5 story so much that I gave up.
Okay. Yeah, I get that. Nah, I get that. GTA, I gave up on 5 because I didn't like the storyline. But I fucking love the Ballad of Gay Tony in 4. I love that shit, dude. Oh, my God. It was so good.
Yeah.
Ballad of Gay Tony?
Like, dude, it's about a dude who's a gay dude that owns, like, the most popular gay club. And he's like, this is my shit. I ain't going to let nobody take it over. The Ballad of Gay Tony in GTA 4 is literally the best game. Like, fuck GTA 4 itself.
Yeah.
Ballad of Gay Tony was amazing. Like, seriously. That's amazing.
I've heard the same thing from other people. I think you and I have talked about it that one as well.
Mm-hmm.
But, man.
So good.
But, yeah, for me, yeah, Persona, Paper Mario, Blue Dragon, Pokemon especially is extremely replayable. I will delete a file and replay it.
The opposite, because I work so hard in that I find it so difficult to delete a file.
Yeah, but I think now also with the new home thing, it's a lot easier because everything's saved now, so you can just replay it and then just add it to your Pokemon.
Still ain't doing that. No, I ain't gonna. I haven't done my
it. I haven't done with Sword. I haven't done it with Sword yet, but Or do I have shield? I forget which one I have. I have sword. Yeah, I haven't done it yet, but I did do it with Soul Silver because I love Silver is like yeah. Like Sun and Moon's my favorite one, and it got stolen from me. And so I never got to replay it. But then it's Silver Gold, and I love playing Silver. I love the story. So I will refresh.
No, I get that. I like how you like said simple games, like just mindless games is what like makes it replayable. But I ain't gonna lie either. I love Minecraft, man. That game, you don't do nothing. Yeah. Just build some shit, punch some trees, jump off the cliffs, fight Enderman and everything. Man, it's such a game.
I didn't even know that there was a boss battle until very recently.
Yeah, there's some of a story, really. Yeah.
There's two things, because they did the dungeon crawler kind of version of Minecraft as well too.
Dungeons,
they tried to do like a story mode, I think, actually, and it's like about the guy named Steve doing some Steve shit. I have no idea what the storyline is. I have Steve no shit. Clue.
I've watched the thing of Game Theory, and they like we found the story for Minecraft. Basically, the entire story is the entire belief of you spend too much time playing Minecraft. Get the fuck outside and enjoy the rest of your life.
That's pretty funny.
That's not his story. Like, good for them. Good for them.
Go build a real house. But alrighty, guys. It looks like we're coming up until the end.
Really?
Thank you guys so much. Quick. I know, right? It was fun. I love talking about some video games, replayability, and talking about. I hope let us know what games are replayable for you. Please let us know. Like, what do you love replaying and just starting over, starting fresh? Yeah.
Tell us what game you want Tyler to play, because it's not going to be just Sonic. It's going to be some other shit too.
That's what we should just do. We should just do a Twitch and like just make Tyler play different games that he never played. Make you
play Sonic. I swear to baby Jesus. I'm going to make you play.
When we can see each other again, we'll do it.
I promise. It won't be the shitty ones. Like, I won't make you play like Shadow. No, I won't.
Thank you.
That'll be a Twitch stream.
What about Unleashed? What was it? The Sonic Unleashed or something like that? Unleashed where he's like the werewolf?
Is bad, but not as bad as 2006 Sonic. Of course. There's some levels, dog.
No. I saw a meme somewhere. It was like the SpongeBob Patrick meme, where it's like, oh, like all modern Sonic games are bad. And like the only two examples that they can prove wrong was Mania and Generations.
Yeah, I ain't gonna bullshit. Yeah, those are really good too.
Matt, where can they find more of you though?
If you want to find more of me, you see that logo right behind there where it says NerdyBit? Just where's my arm? There, you see that? Just Google me.
I'm looking at the waifu Nerdy on the bit. Screen.
You can look at the waifu, but if you slightly move your head slightly to the center of where the waifu is, you see the logo where it says NerdyBit. Just Google it. Google it. Look up our website. Go look at our Instagram. I'm here. Just find me. I have shit. You can buy my shit. I have clothing. I have hats. You see the hat that Tyler's wearing? I made that for him. We have hats. We have clothing. We have other things that I can't remember off the top of my head. So please, Google
all the things. Alrighty. And Jeffrey, where can they find you?
You can find me on Instagram at Kibbles Plays, and then you can also find me here on other episodes of Gamer Culture.
Alrighty. And thanks for listening in. You can check out all of our shows and offerings on thegrandgeekgathering.com, where you can find our articles, our other podcasts, and so much more. Please like and subscribe to this video. That really would help us out. And we have some awesome videos coming out, like Popmosis, Mostly Stream Ranking Challenge, and Gamer Culture as well. Also, check me out on Twitch. I do stream every once in a while. We are on a hiatus from Marvel Talkbacks until Loki comes out, but I'll be doing some other things on Twitch. Join our Discord. Have a wonderful week. Wear a mask. And GGG.
And stay cultured, my friend.
And stay cultured.